It's prospect season again, and every team loves to overrate their own guys this time of year. The interesting one right now to talk about for the Colorado Avalanche is Oskar Olausson.
Alex Newhook!
Oh boy.
Whoa!
Now, let's start off by making a couple of things clear when it comes to Olausson. He is the highest picked player in the Avs system as far as prospects are concerned at 28th overall, and his ceiling realistically is a top 6 goal scorer, but there's still a long way to go for him to get there. When it comes to what Olausson does well, no better to tell you than the man himself.
Good skater, fast, good shot, good hockey IQ. I mean, it's just hockey, so go out there and play, have fun, work hard. I think that's it.
There is no doubt that his skating, size, and shooting ability combined to make an extremely tantalizing prospect. This past season was Olausson's draft plus 1 year, and he came to North America to play in Canadian juniors in the OHL. This was a twofold change for him, as previously he had played in Europe on the significantly larger ice and in professional hockey. Now moving down to juniors on the tight American ice, you would expect some adjustments to North America, but also to confidently dominate younger players. Initially, Olausson showed some very solid success with the Barrie Colts, where he put up over a point per game numbers and was confident in their top six. About halfway through the season, though, Olausson was traded to the Oshawa Generals in a bit of an odd trade. It didn't really make a ton of sense for Oshawa, and Oshawa struggled to find Olausson a consistent role throughout the team. This put Olausson in a bit of an odd spot, and you saw his production dip quite a bit compared to when he was in Barrie. However, on the whole of the season, he still put up 49 points in 55 games, including 26 goals, which are good, but not great numbers for a D+1 player in the OHL. After a first-round exit in the OHL playoffs, Olausson would go to the AHL in the Colorado Eagles, where he would play in their playoffs as well, against professional competition in North America. He looked fairly solid. He would pick up 2 points in 4 playoff games there, seeing the production in his first few AHL games is a very good sign. At the time this video is posted, he is also playing in the redo of the World Junior Championships over this summer, and is playing pretty well, but you can check out our piece over on thednvr.com when it comes up for more on him at the WJCs specifically. So all of this has set up for a solid, if not spectacular, year for the only first-round pick left in the Avs system. Now, as it stands, the Avs prospect pool is a little bit thin. And the idea is that Olausson helps boost that. There is little doubt he is in the top 3 of the Avs prospect pool, and some would even argue that he is the number 1 prospect in the system. And honestly, I think that's fair enough based on his ceiling, but that ceiling has a lot of work to get there. There is absolutely a world where Olausson becomes a 30-plus goal scorer in the NHL and is an extremely effective top 6 winger. But I don't want your expectations to run wild. I want to set the stage here a little bit on what a realistic expectation should be for a guy drafted 28th overall. Olausson has a bunch of high-end talent. There's no doubt about that. But there are a few things he does need to improve on. Number 1, for me, is his off-the-puck play. When he's playing away from the puck, he oftentimes gets caught flat-footed, not engaging in the play, not doing a good enough job defensively, getting in passing lanes, staying engaged, and offensively, he needs to do a better job finding open space and making himself an option for his teammates. On the whole, with the puck, very satisfied with what Olausson is capable of. He certainly is a better shooter than anything else, but is capable of distributing pucks effectively when he wants to be. When he uses his size in an effective manner, it can be extremely beneficial to not only him, but his entire team. He has the ability to dig out pucks and make quality plays beyond just his high skill level in shooting and puck carrying. But he needs to do that more effectively. He needs to use his size. He needs to take advantage of it. Especially when the puck is on his stick, he needs to do a better job of out-muscling players and protecting it. So there's certainly some give and take with the high-end qualities and the parts of Olausson's game that need work. If you're just watching this video to get highlights of Olausson's season and a recap of it, you can turn it off here. But if you want realistic expectations, I want to take a look at the last 20 years of the 28th overall pick and see what we can reasonably expect. Let's start off with the last 4 years of the 28th overall pick. That's 2022 through 2019. These are all kind of too early to tell players. None of them have broken into the NHL yet. Obviously, Olausson in 21. 22 saw Jiří Kulič as a interesting Czech prospect. 2020 saw Ridley Gregg, who significantly outproduced Olausson in Canadian Juniors this past season. However, he is a year older. And 2019 saw Ryan Suzuki, who is now playing in the AHL but is not putting up spectacular numbers and has been battling injury. Getting into the first player on this list who has actually played an NHL game, you have Nils Lundqvist, taken by the New York Rangers, and even he has only played in 25 NHL games so far. Now, it is a bit tough to compare defensemen directly to a forward like Olausson here, but they did take similar-ish paths to the NHL. Both of them came from Sweden, playing in professional leagues over there, only to make the jump to North America. Now, Lundqvist spent significant time staying in Sweden playing pro, while Olausson decided to jump over and play juniors. Lundqvist, in his first year in North America, split time between the AHL and the NHL. Still, as a 21-year-old, he managed to push his way into an NHL role with solid play in the AHL, and it looks like he probably has a decent chance to stick in the NHL. After this, you start to get a more solid picture of what these level of picks start to become at the NHL level, and it is fairly varied, but you're going to start noticing some patterns. Starting with the 28th overall pick from 2017, oh, right. Yeah. One of the patterns you're going to notice is the Avs have not had any success with 28th overall picks. And while I know the Avs did not draft Shane Bowers, they have taken him and failed to develop him into an NHL player so far. Fun fact, did you know Shane Bowers is the only player from the first round of the 2017 NHL draft to not play an NHL game? I'm not going to put a ton of stock into this because Bowers is a very, very different player than Olausson. Bowers was touted on defensive acumen and the offensive side of his game was always a big question mark. Something that the Avs seem to grade very harshly against when it comes to their prospects. If they struggle to produce at the AHL level, they rarely get call-up opportunities. Moving on to 2016, you have the Washington Capitals taking Lucas Johansson, and at this point, he is a bust. Again, another defenseman, so not a perfect comparison, but after playing one extra year in juniors, he graduated to the AHL level, and then never really got his game off of the ground there. There is some hope that he's a little bit of a late bloomer, as his most recent season was his best in the AHL, and he managed to play his NHL debut, which isn't nothing, but still a long way from being an NHL impact player. Our first real success story comes from 2015, where the Isles took Anthony Beauvillier 28th overall. Beauvillier has a quicker route to the NHL than Olausson is going to have. After playing his D+1 in the QMJHL, he jumped immediately to the NHL level and has not looked back. In the NHL, Beauvillier has settled into a 30-40 point third line player for the Islanders. Playing on the left wing and a left shot, he is probably the prototype model that you're looking for with Olausson. With a 21 goal season and a few 18 goal seasons in the bag, I think this is a somewhat realistic projection. The difference is, Beauvillier, his game was always built for a third line type role. Yes, he's a little bit on the smaller side, but he's always been extremely tenacious at digging out pucks, getting to the dirty areas, and doing what it takes. So while those things might not align super well with a projection of Olausson, the shooting first and being a very good skater do line up. And this, I think, is the first key example of where Olausson is going to need to grow. If he's going to play in a bottom six role, which I think a third line is a reasonable projection for him, if he's going to be successful in the NHL, he's going to have to learn how to be more aggressive, play more physical, especially off the puck. He's going to have to be smarter and more effective. Continuing down the list, you have another New York Islander player at 2014 in Josh Hosang. This one is a little bit of a weird one, kind of an outlier. It would appear on the ice, Hosang certainly has the ability to be an NHL caliber player. However, there are a number of issues off the ice that have caused him problems and limited his opportunity. I have very little interest in digging into these issues on this, it's just not relevant, but just something to keep in mind that it's not just hockey that can derail a prospect's career sometimes. 2013 saw the Calgary Flames taking Morgan Klimchuk at the 28th pick, and he is a bust. A bit of an interesting one, though. There did seem to be some talent there. After graduating to the AHL level, he put up two very solid seasons and managed to earn his NHL debut. But after that debut, he just struggled in the following years at the AHL level, being traded multiple times and failing to come even close to his initial production. His last season playing hockey was in 2019-20. I've tried to find any details on him from there. I'm not sure if his retirement from playing has anything to do with the pandemic happening or not, but the only thing I can find is that he is now coaching at a junior level. So, not exactly sure what happened to Morgan Klimchuk's career, but it's another 28th overall pick that ultimately failed to have an impact at the NHL level. We have another successful one in 2012 with the New York Rangers, the other New York team this time drafting Brady Shea at 28th overall. After playing 3 years in college, Shea would play a full year at the AHL level before graduating to the NHL. As far as timeline is concerned, that would line up pretty well with what I would hope for Olausson. Shea, as a defenseman, has been an everyday defender since joining the NHL, and at times has even peeked into teams' top 4D. This is the last decade of picks at the 28th overall spot, and only two of them are successful everyday NHLers. This is the reality I'm trying to set. If Olausson becomes an everyday NHLer, that is a win with that pick. 2011 brings us another bust where Minnesota took Zach Phillips. As a right shot forward, Phillips never quite put his game fully together at the AHL level, and ultimately his career still going on in Europe, but never really challenged for a proper NHL spot. You do find another solid pick in 2010 with Charlie Coyle, another player who quickly proved himself in the AHL, playing about half a season there before graduating to the NHL and sticking. This is not an uncommon situation for players in this draft range. In the Avs case, you can take JT Compher as a perfect example like that, and in my opinion, is probably the best case scenario for Olausson to get to the NHL as fast as possible. Given his coming over to North America and giving his lack of experience playing against professionals in North America, I would give Olausson at least half a season in the AHL to get fully adjusted and comfortable. In Coyle's case, he, like most of the successful forwards on this list, settled into a 30 to 40 point range and an effective third line player. Coyle did, however, see a bit of a bump in his prime, topping out at a 56 point season. That is what you're looking at when you're starting to hope for the best you're going to get out of Olausson. 2009 saw Chicago draft Dylan Olsen, and 2008 saw the Arizona Coyotes draft Victor Tikhonov. Both of them did reach the 100 game mark, but neither of them were ever significantly impactful players. Olsen was a defensive defenseman that just didn't really fit with where the modern game was going, and Tikhonov, coming over from Russia, failed to produce at an effective rate in the NHL and couldn't transfer his game into a bottom six role. That is the big fear with Olausson. If he ends up busting, that's probably going to be why. 2007 saw another bust in Nick Petrecki. No real need to go deep into any of those guys anymore. In 2006, Ottawa drafted Nick Foligno. Certainly one of the more successful players at the 28th overall pick, at least in modern history. He has over 1,000 games. He's been a staple NHL player for well over a decade. With that being said, you're starting to develop a model of a successful NHL forward drafted in this range. Gritty, plays hard, is capable of filling a bottom six role, even if that isn't necessarily scoring all the time. Foligno also matches another pattern in this system. Usually a 30 to 40 point player, but has a peak that is surprisingly high. Foligno, a bit of an outlier, his peak season, a 73 point year in Columbus, stands alone with no other seasons really coming close to that, but he did have another 51 point and 47 point season, so there are a couple of very solid years there in his prime. And I want to reiterate, if you get a handful of years at 30 to 40 points from Olausson and then peak out somewhere at 50 plus, you should be ecstatic. 2005 saw Matt Niskanen get drafted, one of the few Stanley Cup champions on this list, as he won one with Washington a handful of years ago. Same kind of story. After proving he could be an everyday NHLer, he had a solid peak, including a 40-point season, which is fairly large for a defenseman, and kind of hung around as a 4th D or in bottom pairings for a lot of his career. 2004 saw Mark Fistrick get drafted, had a solid 300-game career as a bottom pairing defensive defenseman. And then we get to 2003. The gold standard of the 28th overall pick. Certainly the best pick from what we're covering, arguably the best 28th overall pick ever, depending on how you feel about Justin Williams. The Anaheim Ducks, with the 28th pick in 2003, took Corey Perry. And I'm going to be honest with you, even if absolutely everything goes right with Olausson, I'm not sure he becomes Corey Perry. But this is the absolute ceiling. This is akin to winning the lottery if you get something like this out of the 28th overall pick. It's possible. You could get this caliber of player, but it's just extremely unlikely. So if you're a big dreamer, if you really want to believe in Olausson's potential, you can set yourself up for a Corey Perry-level career. For reference, that sets you up for a 50-goal season, multiple over-point-per-game seasons, and just a ton of effective hockey. And finally, in 2002, you have the Avs picking at 28th overall. They took Jonas Johansson. No, not that Jonas Johansson. Same name, though. Oh, look, he's a 6'2" winger from Sweden who only managed to get into one NHL game. Obviously, this was 20 years ago, so it's not fair to put the blame on the Avs. It's a completely different organization at this point, and it's not super relevant to Olausson. But it just goes to show, the Avs, as well as the majority of the league, have struggled to be successful with the 28th overall pick. There are a handful of successful players that you can get from this range, but it's not too easy to come by. Realistically, for a player like Olausson, in this range, if you get a third-line goal-scoring forward, you've crushed it. If you get an everyday NHLer, that's success. Now, anything is possible. Of course, plenty of great players have gotten picked well after the 28th pick, too. There's always that chance. But the reality and playing the odds, when you're setting expectations, getting an NHLer at all out of Olausson is enough to make you happy. I don't want to put down Olausson. I don't want to tell you that I don't think he's an NHLer. He absolutely could be. Obviously, we're not there yet, and there's still a lot of runway left to go. But I do want to be realistic, because you should not be setting yourself up for a guy that you think is going to be a top six player and put 40 goals in. It's just so unlikely to happen. Should be realistic, and then you won't be disappointed with the ultimate result, at least depending on what it is, as much. So just a little bit of a reality check that I wanted to do here on one of the Avs' top prospects. I hope you enjoyed the video. That is the end of this one. We will talk to you on the next one, or you can go check all of our content over on thednvr.com.